reading this. My mama sitting there. Looks like I only got one way ticket over here. I sure wish I could give you one more kiss. And war was just a game we played when we were kids. Well, I'm laying down my gun, I'm hanging up my boots. I'm up here with God, and we're both watching over you. So lay me down in that open field out on the edge of town. And oh, my soul is where my mama always prayed that it would go. And if you're reading this, I'm already home. If you're reading this, halfway around the world, I won't be there to see the birth of our little girl. I hope she looks like you. I hope she fights like me. She stands up for the innocent and the weak. Well, I'm laying down my gun, I'm hanging up my boots. Tell Dad I don't regret that I followed in his shoes. So lay me down in that open field out on the edge of town. And oh, my soul is where my mama always prayed that it would go. If you're reading this, I'm already home. If you're reading this, there's gonna come a day where you'll move on and find someone else, and that's okay. Just remember this, I'm in a better place, where soldiers live in peace and angels sing amazing grace. So lay me down in that open field out on the edge of town. And oh, my soul, where my mama always prayed that it would go. And if you're reading this, oh, if you're reading this, I'm already home.
For many, Memorial Day weekend is just another holiday. Time to get out of town, time to grill some burgers, time to go to the lake or watch the Indianapolis 500. There's not a thing wrong with any of those things. But if that's all we do on Memorial Day weekend, that's wrong. Someone said, and I quote, "The temptation is to enjoy the fruits of citizenship without tending the tree of liberty," end quote. The fact is, many of us haven't done a thing to enjoy the freedoms that we have. But someone did. Somebody else sacrificed their freedoms so we could have ours. Most of us didn't go to foreign lands and fight for our freedoms, but someone did. Most of us didn't shed our own blood, but someone did. The blood, sweat, and tears given on behalf of the freedoms of the United States of America, in most cases, were shed by someone else besides us. We don't know them all, but we owe them all. Every one of them. Towering over Edinburgh, Scotland, is the Edinburgh Castle. In the middle of some very old buildings is a newer structure. It's the World War I Memorial. On it is a quotation from Thucydides that says this, and I quote, "The whole earth is a tomb of heroic men, and their story is not graven only on stones over their clay, but abides everywhere without visible symbol woven into the stuff of others' lives," end quote. That's certainly true for us here this morning. Our story is only possible because of the sacrifices made by others, others we call veterans. And we can't thank them today. But if you're here this morning and you had a relative or a friend that gave their life fighting for the freedoms of our country, we can thank you. Would you stand? If you have a relative or a friend who died serving our country, would you stand and let us thank you this morning? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank all of you. God bless you. And I would be remiss if I didn't have every serviceman, every servicewoman, every person in the U.S. Armed Forces right now risking your life on behalf of our country. Would you stand and let us recognize you and thank you as well? Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. On May 5th, 2011, the last combat veteran of the First World War died. His name was Claude Chules. He was born British. He died in a nursing home in Perth, Western Australia, at the age of 110. He served in the Australian Navy for 41 years and published a book called The Last of the Last at the age of 108. He was actually a witness to the 1918 surrender of the German High Seas Fleet, the main battle fleet of the German Navy during the war. The last American soldier from World War I, Frank Buckles, died the same year, 2011, in February. The story about Frank is that he lied about his age so he could go and serve. He was too young, but he wanted to go and serve his country and fight for our freedoms. Now they're all gone. And so are many of the things they fought for. Whatever happened to America? Whatever happened to the America that our veterans fought for? Historian M.E. Bradford, in his book Original Intentions, said, and I quote, that 95% of our founding fathers were Christians, end quote. Now, today all we hear is separation of church and state. And Thomas Jefferson is credited with coining that phrase, separation of church and state. But did you know that he served as superintendent of schools for Washington, D.C. when he was president? And did you know that he required the Bible be taught at every grade level in every classroom in Washington, D.C. school system? How come we never hear that part of the story? How come that's never on CNN or Fox News or NBC or ABC? How come they never tell us the whole truth, just part of it? The New England Primer, published in 1777, was the basic textbook for children for the first 100 years here in America when it came to public education. And it trained young children how to learn their ABCs with words from the Bible. Today, our children are encouraged to read Heather Has Two Mommies. Of the first 108 universities founded in America, 106 were distinctly Christian, including the first, Harvard University. Chartered in 1636, primarily as a place, are you ready for this? To train preachers. In the original Harvard student handbook, rule number one was that students seeking entrance must know Latin and Greek. Why? So they could study the scriptures. What happened to America? Now students are not allowed to pray at high school football games or use the name of Jesus in graduation ceremonies. I heard in the news of a school, it said it was Liverpool, but it's in America, and said that these kids were told, you're not going to be allowed to sing the Lord's Prayer at your graduation ceremony this year, and they went ahead and sang it anyway. God bless every one of them. Today we're seeing the federal courts almost completely hostile toward Christianity. That hasn't always been the case. In 1891, the majority opinion of the U.S. Supreme Court in Church of the Holy Trinity versus the United States said this, quote, our laws and our institutions must necessarily be based upon and embody the teachings of the Redeemer of mankind. And it's impossible that it should be otherwise. And in this sense and to this extent, our civilization and our institutions are emphatically Christian, end quote. You know, lawyers like to quote legal precedent. How about that one? In 1954, Chief Justice Earl Warren said, and I quote, I believe no one can read the history of our country without realizing that the good book and the spirit of the Savior have from the beginning been our guiding geniuses, end quote. But you know, if some of the veterans who fought for our country and died for our country years ago were somehow able to come back to America today, they would wonder what had happened to the country they fought and died for. I think they'd be shocked by $2.30 for gasoline. Now, most of us today are going, hey, we're glad the price is down. They'd be stunned by that. They'd be stunned that people pay for bottled water. But they'd also be stunned that we have abortion on demand and that the Supreme Court has redefined marriage. They'd be stunned that people can't make it through their day without their cell phones or Starbucks. I wonder how they'd respond to our national obsession with political correctness. Or our personal obsession with materialism. I wonder how they'd respond to Olympic champion Bruce Jenner becoming a woman and now a champion for the transgender movement. How would they respond to our removing prayer from schools and the fact that the Ten Commandments in the Bible are no longer welcome into our public schools? Then our president sends a directive that every public school has to provide transgender access to restrooms or face the loss of federal funds. Ladies and gentlemen, I don't know what you call that, but I call that blackmail, and I call that wrong. I wonder what they'd think of how we've allowed terrorists to alter our way of life and how naive most people have come about the spread of radical Islam all over the world, even here at home in America. I think if our veterans, if they could come back, they would wonder what happened to the country they fought for. And if we keep going the way we're going, it won't be very long. There won't be anything left to fight for. If you have your Bibles, turn to Psalm chapter 11. Chapter 11 is a passage written by a man who was no stranger to battle scars and sacrifice. His name was David. He was Israel's greatest king. He was also their most courageous warrior. And in this passage, he shares some incredible advice that should be encouraging to every one of us this Memorial Day weekend. So would you stand for the reading of God's Word today? Psalm chapter 11, beginning in verse 1. Here's what David writes. In the Lord I take refuge. How can you say to my soul, flee like a bird to your mountain? For behold, the wicked bend the bow. They have fitted their arrow to the string to shoot in the dark at the upright in heart. If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? The Lord is in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. His eyes see, his eyelids test the children of man. The Lord tests the righteous, but his soul hates the wicked and the one who loves violence. Let him rain coals on the wicked, fire and sulfur, and a scorching wind shall be the portion of their cup. For the Lord is righteous. He loves righteous deeds. The upright shall behold his face. You may be seated, and may God add his blessing to the reading of his word. Now notice what David says that we need to do. First of all, he says we need to face our fears. Face your fears. You know, no one is exempt from fear. So David says, trust in the Lord. You don't need to run. Some had evidently encouraged him to just run to the mountains like a bird, flee like a bird to the mountains. Notice in verse 2, his insight on the insidiousness of the wicked. He says this, they have fitted their arrow to the string to shoot in the dark at the upright in heart. His enemies were cowards. They fired their shots in the dark. They were hiding under the cover of darkness while no one was watching, while no one was paying attention. You know, that's happening today. As people try to rewrite our history and remove God and godly people from our past and from our present and even from our future. There are people right now trying to remove the phrase, one nation under God, from the Pledge of Allegiance. In fact, some schools in the United States right now forbid children to recite the Pledge of Allegiance. In America. What's happened to America? Others are trying to remove In God We Trust from our coins and our currency. I don't know if you've been paying attention or not, but there's been a move recently, and apparently it's been approved, I'm not sure by whom, but to take Andrew Jackson off the $20 bill and replace it with a woman. Now, I'm not against having a woman on the $20 bill. I'm against a woman having a $20 bill, my wife. I'm kidding. That's not the issue. I had a gentleman come up after service. He said, you know the real reason why they want Andrew Jackson off the $20 bill? I said, no, sir. He says, because he did away with the Federal Reserve, and under his term, America was debt-free. But I think there's another reason why they're making changes to our money, because then they can come along and make another revision and take In God We Trust right off our money and say, well, there's already precedent. We've been making other changes, and before you know it's gone. It's gone. Now, some people will say, well, you know, Pastor, that's not that big a deal. I mean, really, does it matter if it says In God We Trust on a coin? Does it matter if it says In God We Trust on a $20 bill? I mean, really, is that big a deal? Yeah, it's a big deal. You know why? Because all that has to happen is just little by little. And all of a sudden, you wake up and there's a problem. There's a story that came out of the Civil War. I don't know if it's true, but it illustrates the point that when the North was fighting the South, there was a lady. She was standing out by the fence with a rake, and the soldiers came out and said, ma'am, you can't be out here. And she said, well, I want people to know whose side I'm on. And they said, well, that's good, that's wonderful, but you need to go back in the house. And then they asked her, they said, listen, could we use some of the rails on the fence for firewood tonight to keep our troops warm? And she said, sure. She said, just only use the top rail. And when she came out in the morning, the whole fence was gone. But all they did was burn the top rail. Friend, listen, it matters when these little tiny things that we think are insignificant and not important, we need to stand up and say, no, you don't. Our country was not founded by Muslims. Our country was founded by Christians. I've said it for years, and I wouldn't be surprised, and I think it may happen in my lifetime, if they don't sandblast all the references to God and the Scriptures from all of our national monuments and all of our national buildings. It's coming, folks. It's coming. And I think if our veterans were here today, they'd say, wake up, America! We used to know what was right. Now we don't. I mean, common sense used to rule our country. Now it's no sense at all. Verse 3, David, he says, here's the bottom line. If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? Now, it's interesting, the word foundations in the original language, in the Hebrew in which the Old Testament was written, means the settled order of things. I love that. The settled order of things. Do you know where the settled order of things comes from? The Word of God. You can't have civilization. You can't have a settled order of things without the principles of the Word of God. That's where they all come from. God's the one that created this universe. He's the one that created this world. He's the one that created these principles that we used to hold dear. The foundation of society is law and order, justice, and truth. And if law and order and justice and truth are undermined in a society, what can the righteous do? David says. Now, by the way, in the original language, when David asked this question, he formed it in such a way that he's saying, I can find no answer. In other words, if the foundations are destroyed, there's nothing we can do. And that's exactly what's happening in Western society today. The very foundations that have made it work and made it great, law and order, truth and justice, morality and decency, integrity and common sense, are all being destroyed. And when the foundations are destroyed, we're in trouble. Humanist and libertarian views prevail in our schools, our courts, our government, in the media. A concerted attack is being waged against everything decent and moral and godly. Former President Calvin Coolidge said, quote, the foundations of our society and our government rest so much on the teachings of the Bible that it would be difficult to support them if faith in these teachings would cease to be practically universal in our country, end quote. That's a great quote. In other words, if we get to the place where people no longer recognize the Bible and how important it is to our society, we're cooked. Sounds a lot like Psalm 11:3 to me. If the foundations are destroyed, what can the righteous do? Face your fears, David said. Number two, he says, face the facts. What are the facts? When you find yourself gripped with fear and disillusionment, what can the righteous do? You need to remember the facts. Here they are. First of all, David says, remember where the Lord sits. Verse 4. He said, the Lord sits in his holy temple. The Lord's throne is in heaven. It may look like God has abdicated his throne, or maybe he's forgotten what's going on down here. He hasn't. He is sovereignly and securely on his throne. Now, he has an endless array of options to deal with the situations that men face. I'll just give you a couple. Number one is revival. God could send revival. There's nothing like an old-fashioned Holy Ghost revival for cleaning up a corrupt culture in a sin-infested society. Revival would be amazing. Now, I know when I say that, some of you are going, what's a revival? Never. You have no idea what a revival is because it's been so long. A revival is where things turn around. A revival is when a prophet like Jonah follows the word of God and goes to a city like Nineveh that was incredibly wicked, and the people realize the seriousness of their sin, and they repent with sackcloth and ashes, and they cry out to God, and they said, we ask your forgiveness, and God does not destroy that city. So I don't know anything about Nineveh. What if it was Las Vegas or New York City? And suddenly those entire cities turned to God. Yeah, revival would be amazing. The devil is no match for a genuine heaven-sent revival. One really good, life-changing, soul-saving, culture-transforming, earth-shaking revival could put righteousness and morality and integrity and faith and common sense back into every aspect of our society, just like that. God could send revival. Or he could allow ruin. You know, God could just as easily allow sinful man to have his way and let all hell break loose. God could say, you don't want me in culture, you don't want my influence, you don't want my people, you don't want my word, you don't want my son, all right, we're out of here. And friend, if you know your Bible, that's exactly what's going to happen in the end times. And all hell will break loose, and it won't be a party. So we see where the Lord sits. Notice what the Lord sees, verse the last part of verse 4 and verse 5, His eyes see, his eyelids test the children of man. God doesn't miss a thing. You may think he does. God doesn't miss a thing. He sees everything, and he tests everyone. God isn't dead, and he isn't blind, nor is he detached from the world in which you and I live. No, far from being detached and disinterested, he narrows his eyes. He literally focuses in to make sure he's seeing exactly what man is doing and exactly what man is made of. God puts man in the crucible to reveal whether we are genuine or disingenuous. And that may be nothing more than what's happening today. God is allowing us to be tested to find out who really is following in him and who's just faking it. And I have to tell you, based on the mess in our country, the 260-some million people who claim to be Christians, there's a whole lot of fakers among us. Because if 260 million Christians were really living for Jesus, you'd have revival. And we wouldn't have the mess we're in. Where the Lord sits, what the Lord sees, notice what the Lord sends. Last part of verse 5 and verse 6. His soul hates the wicked and the one who loves violence. Let him rain coals on the wicked, David says. Fire and sulfur and a scorching wind shall be the portion of their cup. Two things I want you to notice here. Number one, God doesn't let anybody get away with anything. Now, it may seem like it. It may seem like God is forgot or God didn't see or somehow they got away with it. I have a pastor friend who used to tell me the wheels of God's justice move slowly but surely. You know, it may not seem like God's involved. It may not seem like God's watching. It may not seem like God's keeping score here and he's gonna balance the scales. But listen, nothing could be farther from the truth. Now, in verse 6, this is actually a prayer from David. David is praying for God to rain down fire and brimstone on the wicked. Now, I know some of you, you can't possibly conceive in your mind of a godly man praying a prayer like that. But I got to be honest with you, we do. We do. David did. God said of him, he's a man after my own heart. So how could a godly man pray that? Well, listen, if there's no other answer, if revival's impossible, God's honor has to be upheld. You know, one of the things that bugs me about what's happening in America is people are all concerned about hurting someone's feelings. Have you picked up on that in our society? They're all concerned about, well, we don't want to offend this group, or we don't want to say, you know, it's political correctness, all that kind of stuff. Where are the people who say we don't want to offend God? Whatever happened to God's heart? Whatever happened to God's way? Whatever happened to God's word? Whatever happened to God's will? Why doesn't somebody say, I want to make sure I'm not offending God? So David said, bring fire down. Yeah. By the way, and this isn't in my notes, but remember when, this is David, this is the same guy who went out in the Valley of Elah one day, and the whole army of Israel was over on one side, and all the Philistines were over on the other side, and there was a big mouth giant over there mocking God and mocking God's people. And they were all scared to death to fight him. And you know what David said when he went out there? With no sword, no shield, just his little slingshot and some stones. He said, you have blasphemed the name of my God. And you're going down. And he did. Where are the people like that today? Where are godly, Christian, holy, righteous people who say, you have blasphemed the name of my God and you won't do it again? Instead, we just sit by and let them change laws and do all kinds of stuff until there's not going to be any freedoms left. In fact, if you're not paying attention, radical Islam is a huge threat to the United States of America. Unless you want to be wearing a towel on your head and bending down five times a day to Mecca, you'd better start standing up for what you believe in. Someone's going to say, Pastor, you shouldn't have said that. I just did. Just did. David said, God, rain down fire and sulfur from heaven. Now listen, that happened to Sodom and Gomorrah. God rained down so much fire and so much sulfur on those wicked cities of Sodom and Gomorrah that men have to guess where they are today. That's what David prayed. He says, face your fears. He says, face the facts. Thirdly, he says, face your future. Verse 7. Whatever happens, one thing is for sure, righteousness will win in the end. The ultimate reward of the righteous will be to see the face of God. Listen, don't miss this. This is what David says. He says, for the Lord is righteous. He loves righteous deeds. The upright shall behold his face. Those are three truths that you can't change. Government can't legislate them away. The LGBT community can't come along and say, well, that's offensive. We've got to get rid of it. No, these are things you're not going to move. You're not going to change. Number one, the Lord is righteous. Number two, he loves those who do righteous things. Number three, those who do righteous things will see his face. No one's going to change that. Now, it's not enough for us to say, well, you know, righteousness is going to win out in the end, so, you know, we really don't have to worry about what happens in our world. That's not true. God is counting on us to do something. You say, well, I'm just one person. I can't do much. I can tell you four things you can do. Every single person in this room, four things you can do. Here's number one. Never be ashamed of your American heritage. In fact, stand up for it. Be proud of it. Don't let people tell you, listen, patriotism is a bad thing. Patriotism is not a bad thing. I've got some preacher friends. They don't think that we should ever say anything about America, that we should never, I mean, because America's not in the Bible, and you know, patriotism should never find its place in the pulpit. My Bible tells me in Psalm 33:12, blessed is the nation whose God is the Lord. That's enough for me. And the Bible talks about the nations that forget God. I don't want us to be one of those nations. Don't be ashamed of your American heritage. James Madison in 1785 said, and I quote, we have staked the whole future of American civilization, not on the power of government, far from it. We have staked the future of all of our political institutions upon the capacity of mankind for self-government, upon the capacity of each and all of us to govern ourselves, to control ourselves, and to sustain ourselves according to the Ten Commandments of God, end quote. And now we have people in government positions saying, no, 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 we don't want the Ten Commandments anywhere around. And then we wonder why we have all the problems we have. The very first president of the United States, George Washington, in 1789, in his very first inaugural address said, and I quote, the propitious smiles of heaven can never be expected on a nation that disregards the eternal rules of order and right which heaven itself has ordained, end quote. How come our presidents have gotten so far away from that? And our politicians have gotten so far away from that? Listen, don't ever be ashamed of your American heritage. That's one thing you could do. Here's number two. Live righteously. Live righteously. If just the people in America who claim to be Christians started living like genuine Christians, that would usher in the greatest revival America's ever known. And that starts with us. I mean, don't pray for revival in America if you're not praying for revival in your own heart. That's where it starts. The old gospel chorus used to say, Lord, send a revival and let it begin in me. Dwight L. Moody said, you want to have a revival? Take a piece of chalk, draw a circle around yourself, and say, Lord, send the revival right here. That's where it starts. Number three, stand courageously for the truth. Stand courageously for the truth. Daniel stood in the midst of Babylon, and you and I may be there soon. Peter stood, John stood. They told him, listen, don't say anything else about Jesus. And you know what Peter said to them? He said, well, you go ahead and judge whether in the sight of God and man it's right for us to do what we're doing. But we cannot help but speak of the things we've seen and heard. In other words, Peter said, we're not shutting up. Sorry. We're followers of Jesus Christ. We need more people like that. You know, I'm going to be preaching here in middle of June at a preaching rally up in Illinois. And I asked them, I said, well, what do you want me to speak on? They said, well, we want you to come and fire up some men. Be several hundred men there for that. And I said, okay. And I knew exactly the message that I was going to preach. My favorite Bible character is Shammah. 2 Samuel 23. Shammah was one of David's mighty men. And he was standing in a field of peas when the Philistine army came upon him, and all the other soldiers fled. They ran away, but Shammah stood there, and he fought, and he whipped every one of them. So that's stupid. Why? I mean, it was just a field of peas. No, that was God's field of peas. And he stood there. He courageously stood there. And God brought about a great victory. We need some people like him today. We need some people who stand, even if nobody else will stand with you. Stand courageously for the truth. Then the fourth thing, be a person of hope. So, Pastor, you've shared with us some hopeless stuff today. Oh, yeah, but there's still hope. You see, with God, anything is possible. God could turn, you say, well, nothing great can happen overnight. Well, if God decides it will. But it starts with us. I love what the old Baptist preacher William Cowper wrote. He said, ye fearful saints, fresh courage take. The clouds ye so much dread are big with mercy and shall fall in blessings on your head. Judge not the Lord by feeble sense, but trust him for his grace. Behind a frowning providence, he hides a smiling face. Listen, if you and I would just do the four things I just talked about, that'll honor God. It will honor our veterans, and it'll bring revival to this country. Let's pray.